Hello, welcome. I'm Dr. Tony Malioko, the Cancer Informant. Today we're going to focus on metastatic breast cancer. I've had many patients and questions from women who are living with breast cancer, were either diagnosed with metastatic breast cancer or developed it in the course of their illness. A lot of the information that's currently available focuses on early detection and treatment of early breast cancers. Now, unfortunately, some women present with metastatic breast cancer or develop metastatic breast cancer at some time point after their diagnosis. What is a woman with metastatic breast cancer to do? Well, with any diagnosis of cancer, the first thing is to really confirm the diagnosis. As we learned before, pathology is extremely important. We need to determine with certainty, is the diagnosis correct? Is it possible that this really is breast cancer, or could it be another type of cancer, or might it be something entirely else? So defining the origin of the cancer is extremely important, and confirming that it is metastatic breast cancer is utmost essential. Certain things that may mimic metastatic breast cancer include things like degenerative bone disease that may turn up on an X-ray or scan as a hot part in a bone, a fracture of a bone due to things such as osteoporosis. There might be other cancers that have developed in the patient, for example, melanoma that is metastasized and is mistaken for breast cancer, or there might be a lymphoma or other conditions that may mimic metastatic breast cancer. Now, the best way to diagnose metastatic breast cancer is with a biopsy. So taking a piece of tissue from the metastasis is always the best way to confirm whether or not it's cancer and what is the origin of that cancer. A good pathologist would compare the metastatic lesion with the primary lesion to make sure that it has similar characteristics. Most often, metastatic tumors look a lot like their primary tumors down the microscope, and a pathologist can say with some certainty that this is originating from the primary tumor. In addition, there are certain tests that pathologists can do, special stains that confirm that a metastasis is actually of breast origin. There are certain protein markers that confirm that it's of breast origin, and other markers that are important in selecting treatment. Now, if the lesion is not biopsiable, a blood biopsy can be quite helpful. This is liquid biopsy. I always recommend liquid biopsy in women with metastatic or presumed metastatic breast cancer for a couple of reasons. So one is, first of all, to confirm really is it metastatic breast cancer, and two, to look at the molecular features of the metastasis. One problem is that cancers can change when they metastasize. They may take on different features or they may evolve. A disease like breast cancer is particularly heterogeneous, and so as it progresses, it often develops additional features. For example, a primary tumor might be HER2 negative, but when it metastasizes, it may actually become HER2 positive. As many as 10% of tumors may undergo this change. Likewise, some tumors may be ER positive and they end up losing estrogen receptor expression when they metastasize. An important feature of endocrine positive tumors are that they may develop a mutation that makes them resistant to certain types of anti-estrogen therapy. It's important to know if your tumor has developed this mutation because the anti-estrogen therapy can be changed. There are many different types of anti-estrogen therapy, and getting one that works is of utmost importance. Now, if we take a step back and think about what kinds of breast cancer are there, I like to group them into really four key groups. The first group is the endocrine positive group, so the group that expresses estrogen receptor. This type of tumor is called luminal A or B, and they generally are driven by estrogen hormones and estrogen pathway. There are two types. There's one that is more indolent and another that is more aggressive. This is the B form. Now, sometimes these estrogen positive tumors are highly proliferative and that they will respond to a combination of endocrine hormones plus a CDK4/6 inhibitor, a cyclin-dependent kinase inhibitor. So it is important to know if the tumor does have that metastatic or that proliferative phenotype. In addition, some endocrine-positive tumors will also co-express HER2. So it's important to know if these tumors do have HER2, because trastuzumab or a similar anti-HER2 treatment might also be a consideration. The third group of tumors are the HER2-positive tumors. Now, HER2 is an important protein that a subgroup of breast cancers express highly. Tumors that have high expression of HER2 behave differently. They tend to be more aggressive and have a tendency to metastasize to the organs rather than to the bones. There are many new effective therapies against HER2, so it is important to know if your tumor does actually overexpress HER2. In addition, there's a new category of tumors that is now classified HER2 low. This is where HER2 is present at a measurable amount and may indicate that tumors will respond to new generation of HER2 therapeutics that consist of an anti-HER2 antibody conjugated with something like a topoisomerase inhibitor. This combination is a magic bullet that delivers toxic drug specifically to cancer. It avoids a lot of side effects and appears to be quite effective in women with metastatic breast cancer that do have a HER2 expression, either high or even in the low category. The fourth group of tumors are triple negative. Now, triple negative are not really a category on their own. They really just mean that they don't have the other targetable markers. And so I like to remind people this is quite a mixture of tumors, that they do have different features, but the thing they have in common is that they are ER negative, HER2 negative, and PR negative. Now, one thing to think about is that actually within their triple negative, they might have been classified there on being HER2 2 plus. So there now is a category of triple negative that are actually HER2 low. So it's important to have those triple negatives reassessed to determine if they do actually have some actionable features in them. Another thing, not to alarm any women with breast cancer, but sometimes the triple negative classification is labeled incorrectly, that a stain may have failed. For example, a pathologist thought it was ER negative, but there's actually areas of the tumor that were ER positive, and this tumor has now been misclassified as triple negative. One feature about triple negative tumors is that they often occur in hereditary breast cancer syndromes, such as BRCA, BRCA1 inherited mutations. It's important to determine if a patient does carry these inherited mutations, because the cancers that are associated with BRCA1 and BRCA2 and homologous recombination deficiency are actually treatable with a new class of drugs called PARP inhibitors. This is a big breakthrough in that women who have metastatic disease associated with BRCA1 or 2 or homologous recombination deficiency in their tumors show remarkable response to this class of drug, and this response can be quite durable. Another thing to know about triple negative tumors is that they may express PD-L1, and these tumors may respond well to checkpoint inhibitors. So immunotherapy is also a good option. Now, returning back to liquid biopsy can be quite helpful, because in a liquid biopsy, there are new liquid biopsy techniques that allow us to assess whether or not a tumor is back and also how much of it is circulating in the blood. So evaluating circulating tumor cells can be quite helpful. The cells are captured and examined and counted, so we know exactly how many there are. The more circulating tumor cells there are, obviously, the worse the prognosis. The finding of a few cells can be quite encouraging. Also, in the circulating tumor cells, we can measure whether these cells express estrogen receptor or if they express HER2. This can help us then select therapy against estrogen receptor or HER2, and then even monitor it. The liquid biopsy can easily be repeated, for example, every 3 months to determine if there's a change in the tumor. Has it gone away? Have the number of cells gone down? Or is the tumor becoming resistant? Are the number of cells going up? Is the tumor developing new mutations? Alongside the circulating tumor cell evaluation, I also recommend looking at cell-free DNA. Now, there are two approaches to looking at cell-free DNA. One is called the tumor-informed approach. Some companies are taking the primary tumor and sequencing it for whole exome sequencing to create a customized assay for women to monitor their breast cancer to determine if it's recurred or not. The advantage of this is that the selection is quite specific. The test has been specifically created for a particular woman and is really quite sensitive at determining if the tumor has come back and how much of it is there. However, it does have a downside. The downside of a tumor-informed approach is that it doesn't necessarily contain actionable targets. Actionable targets are things like HER2 or other mutations that might be utilized for therapies. Hence, having a liquid biopsy that has a non-informed approach that actually measures specific mutations related to therapy can be quite helpful, particularly for getting a woman onto an off-label treatment or onto a clinical trial. Another class of drug that is quite important is something called antibody conjugates. And these are really making some impact in women with metastatic breast cancer. I mentioned about trastuzumab that's combined with a toxic chemical that inhibits the proliferation of HER2 positive cells or even HER2 low. But there's another drug that's targeted, or there's another antibody targeted against a marker called TROP2 that's present in triple negative breast cancer that also appears to have good effect. This sacituzumab is showing good effect in women with metastatic breast cancer that are triple negative. There are also additional studies underway to determine if this therapeutic can also be used in other types of breast cancer, so stay tuned for that as well. There's also some exciting developments in the area of estrogen therapeutics in that there are new classes of anti-estrogen drugs, selective estrogen response modulators that are effective against tumors that have become resistant to endocrine therapy. There are many of these now undergoing clinical trials. Now, I should also speak about something called pan-tumor or tumor-agnostic markers. With the explosion of molecular diagnostics, it's now known there are certain classes of mutations that can occur across tumors. You might find them in breast cancer, but also in colon or other types of tumors. And these have been approved by the FDA for treatment, regardless of the site. One of the first to reach this designation was microsatellite instability. This is a type of DNA error where the tumor acquires errors in short repeats of DNA called microsatellites. It's associated often with a syndrome called Lynch syndrome, which is characterized by familial inheritance of cancer, typically of colon and endometrial type. However, there are a small subset of breast cancers that may also exhibit microsatellite instability. The thing about tumors that have microsatellite instability is that they have high tumor mutational burdens and may develop something called neoantigens. The presence of neoantigens are a marker for improved response to immune therapy. So if a tumor does have microsatellite instability or high tumor mutational burden, these tumors may be eligible for treatment with a cell with a checkpoint inhibitor immuno-oncology agent. Hence, it's important to test for that. There are also other pan-tumor agnostic markers. A good one is NTRK. There are several NTRK genes called NTRK 1, 2, and 3, and they may become activated through a process of translocations and fusions, which lead to activation of these particular targets. And in tumors that have these, there is therapeutics that specifically target NTRKs, and breast cancer are one of those types of cancers that may respond to NTRK inhibitor. Now, the most important thing about all of this is that you heard me talk about many different targets. Now, there's no way to know if your tumor is eligible for treatment with a specific therapeutic unless you actually do the molecular testing. And unfortunately, a lot of women do not have the opportunity to have the molecular testing done. Even though it's considered somewhat standard in women with advanced cancer to undergo molecular testing, given the amount of new therapeutics available, it may not have actually been done. So it's important for a patient or their family members to determine if complete testing has been completed and if there are actually any underlying molecular features that might qualify for an FDA-approved treatment or for entry onto a clinical trial. So this is of high importance when considering options for patients living with metastatic breast cancer. Now, the patterns of metastatic breast cancer can be quite variable. One thing I should point out is that women with high-grade who are young or triple-negative breast cancers, if they recur, they tend to recur quite early, and by early, I mean within 5 years. Women with these aggressive diseases, if they've actually survived disease-free for more than 5 years, the probability of the tumor coming back is much lower. Unfortunately, women with lower-grade cancers, such as grade 1 or 2, or endocrine-responsive tumors that proliferate slowly, may have the tumor come back even 8, 10, 15 years later. So they're never really totally free of the risk of the disease returning. Now, women with the higher grade cancers, the tumors tend to return locally or in the region, but they can also recur in other organs, such as the liver, lung, brain, or bones. Now, the tumors that are lower grade, the estrogen positive tumors, often come back in the bone or the skeleton, or in the digestive system, or even on the ovary. Now, the thing with the low-grade tumors is that they can persist for a very, very long time. So some women may survive 10, 15 years or more with metastatic disease and have the options for several lines of therapy. Now, tumors that have the other features can dramatically respond to some of the new targeted agents and particularly immune therapy. It's also important for women with breast cancer to consider genetic testing to determine if they do have those inherited BRCA genes or perhaps some other inherited genes. Now, that's important for them to select their own treatment in terms of PARP inhibitors, but also could be useful when contemplating the type of surgery or treatment. A woman who's at high risk of breast cancer might consider having bilateral mastectomies or consider even having an oophorectomy, given a high risk, if there's some confidence in that diagnosis. Also, that information can be useful for family members to determine if first-degree relatives, such as sisters, aunts, parents, and children, might inherit the gene. Now, the BRCA gene not only causes cancer in women, but it can cause cancer in men as well. So if a patient has passed on that gene to a male member of their family, they may be at risk of prostate cancer, pancreatic cancer, and colon cancer, among other cancers. So it is important to determine if there is a cancer gene being passed through a family. One way to determine if a inherited gene is present is through either doing a germline analysis, which is measuring mutations in saliva or a cheek swab or blood, or in the primary tumor. That sometimes if you do a large sequencing of the primary tumor, we will also sequence those inherited genes, and we can get information as to whether there might be a BRCA family associated gene being passed on. Sometimes the tumor will just damage BRCA itself, and it's not an inherited gene, but it's actually occurring within the tumor, leading to homologous recombination deficiency and susceptibility to PARP. So again, it is important to do these measurements. There are some novel treatments that are now arising. These are things such as vaccines and other types of cell therapy, CAR T therapies, etc. These are much more experimental, but often, again, they rely on the ability to sequence the tumor, measure the mutations that are present, and design specific therapeutics for a patient with those particular characteristics. So in summary, this concludes the discussion of metastatic breast cancer and some of the considerations that a patient should have. At a high level, the first thing is always, one, to confirm the diagnosis. Is this actually metastatic breast cancer, or could it be something else? Secondly, it's extremely important to measure the mutational profile of the metastatic disease. As I said, tumors may change over time, so it's important to know what's happened in that metastasis. Has it acquired HER2 positivity, or the mutations in estrogen receptor, etc.? These measurements can be done on a biopsy or even on a blood sample with a liquid biopsy. The advances in liquid biopsy are really important and help women understand what is happening with their tumors in real time. Liquid biopsy can also be used to determine if a tumor is responding to a therapy or if it appears to be resistant to a therapy. Another test is the genetic test, which is important to determine if a tumor may have underlying genetic predisposition that can also guide therapy and give information to the patient about selecting the type of surgery that they need, future screening, and also information for their family members if they might also be at high risk of cancer and should consider an alternate or enhanced screening protocol. We also learned that there are many exciting new clinical trials that include things with antibody drug conjugates, novel types of immune therapy, and many other exciting advances. So I say the amount of work that's now occurring around breast cancer is truly phenomenal. There are breakthroughs coming at an incredible pace, with new advances being published almost on a weekly basis. So there's a lot of hope there for women with metastatic breast cancer. Thank you for tuning into the Cancer Informant. Please visit our website to hear about other episodes or to subscribe. We also welcome you to leave your questions, which I can address in future episodes. I hope you enjoyed today's episode, and I look forward to connecting with you in the future. Have a wonderful day. Thank you. Bye-bye.